Hello, and welcome to MetaGaming, where everything works the first time, 100% of the time. I'm Llama Chomp.
I'm Lolash. How you going, Llama?
I'm going all right. It's good. It's good. So, this show has traditionally been, we're going to do a little bit different format today than usual. It's traditionally been talking about what games we've been playing, what games we're looking forward to, and it's really been a sort of about what games are being released and what we think of them. It's been sort of a review show. Today, we can't do that. At least I can't do that. I sat down to plan the show and looked at all of the games I've played since the last show, and there's one of them. And it's Factorio. And it's the only thing that I've done. Like, it's not just the only thing I've played, it's also the only thing I've done. There is a 2-week high pile of dishes in my kitchen. There's a 2-week crust of laundry over the entire floor of my house. It is the only thing I've done. So, the idea to give us some excuse to talk about games which are not Factorio in this show was to make it a show about what makes games addictive and to have a theme, which is not a thing we've done before on this cast.
But we thought we'd give it a try.
Yeah.
And of course, that means we are going to be talking about games like Factorio, which is something that we have both played excessive amounts of over the last 2 weeks. But we're also going to dive into looking at some other games and why they sort of have the same effect. We're going to look at things like Stardew Valley. We'll go back for a blast from the past and have a look at the old World of Warcraft syndrome.
You can't talk about addictive games and not mention World of Warcraft, as it is no longer unique or clever or funny to call it.
Yeah, unfortunately. But there's a few other games as well that I want to touch on while we're on that subject. I want to have a little chat about a little game. You may have heard of it. It's being flogged at the moment by most YouTubers and Twitchers. A little game called Enter the Gungeon, which has recently come out, which I've been playing a little bit of when I'm not diving headfirst into conveyor belts. And insert our arms.
How do you... My computer just, like, boots into... The OS is just Factorio. I don't even know how you play other games.
I build a computer in Factorio.
Okay, and you install...
Yeah.
Yeah, all right, yeah, perfect.
And I install.
Right.
All right, let's start with Factorio. Llama,
yeah.
Factorio is a game... Mm-hmm. It is a game that we have played a lot of recently, and we both we'd both heard of this game, right? This game called Factorio, and we knew that like YouTubers and stuff had been hitting it. It was in early access, and neither of us are huge fans of early access games, and neither of us are huge fans of sandbox games. And then I played it on a day.
Mm-hmm.
I played it once. And you played it once, and it's now 2 weeks later, and I'm not sure where all that time went.
Yeah. And this game, like, I don't know if I in the back of my head, if I had more time, if I was writing this show and preparing like a 20-minute YouTube show instead of an off the cuff sort of improvised podcast, you know, if I was writing the script, I would do some study and I would classify different types of addiction, and we would have an actual list. And so I'm going to probably have a list of one, and maybe we'll try to extend that as we go. But this fits in a style of addiction, which is, oh, wait, what happened to the clock? Right? Factorio, it deletes your brain's internal chronometer, and you just don't notice that hours and hours and hours went by because you're too busy doing stuff the entire time.
I think the big thing with Factorio is that you're always busy.
Mm-hmm.
And there aren't many games that can do that to you. A lot of games have you know, level design. They have levels, right? Where you go through a level, or you get a level, or you have some kind of hard cap, some kind of, this is a cutoff point, effectively. Factorio doesn't have that. The closest yep. Factorio has is, you've just installed a new assembly line that builds a thing, but that thing is always needed to build another thing, and you always go, well, I can just now make the thing that I can make out of this thing, and six things later, you look down and your children are starving and you've wet yourself because you forgot that bathroom breaks were a thing you needed to do. Like, it's just... It just sucks. Yeah. Time.
So, it works by this incredible balance of the task you need to do seeming straightforward. Mm-hmm. Right? I need to build a little automator for green science. And then you look at that task, and the first time I looked at that task, it was really daunting. The first time. And then after accomplishing green science, my brain shifted modes, and no task looked daunting. They all looked fairly simple, right? I just need to automate X. And automating X means, well, I need to automate the steps that lead up to it, right? I need to build the components that build the thing I want. But at the same time as you're doing that, so your task has already split off into three tasks. And then you realize that you have a supply chain issue for those tasks, and you get a new task. And then your iron mine dries up, and the game adds another task, and you still haven't finished Blue Science. Like, it's just... This very simple thing, it's been 2 hours, you've been working the entire time on important tasks, and you still have one outstanding. And it's that outstanding task that just, it sets a little trigger in the back of your mind that says, I need to finish a thing in Factorio. And even if you turn the game off to go do something else, that trigger of, like, that unfinished business flag in your brain ropes you back into the game. And it roped me into starting a new save file. Like, it had nothing to do with the task that set off the flag. It had nothing to do with it. I started a new save file because my brain was like, you need to play more Factorio for a perfectly valid reason. And then my conscious mind said, right, but I can't play the save file that's on my stream. But I wanted to start a new factory and do it right anyway. And I just started playing a new factory.
Right is a thing that we're going to come back to because I want to talk about
that. Yeah, it's not really on theme for what makes games addictive, but we might do some rants and ramblings at the end of the show.
I think so. It's a principle which I think... it's called like the Zeigarnik effect, I believe. It's a phenomenon in the brain. I remember reading about this because I struggle with concentration at times. Like, I struggle with focusing on a task. I get very distracted very easily at times. And I did some reading into it. And it's about mental stress and the way an unfinished task works on the human brain. If you have an unfinished task in front of you and you want to complete that task, then it causes stress, like mild stress, not bad stress, not like, oh my god, I'm in tons of debt and I have a life-threatening illness stress, but just that little bit of stress. And then when you complete said task, you get a little reward from your brain. Your brain gives you a little squirt of chemicals that says, hey, good job.
Mm-hmm.
And games like Factorio, and like, full credit to the developers, the guys designing Factorio at the moment have managed to create a game that throws hurdles at you in perfect time increments.
Yep.
I have never played a game where I go from task to task to task to task almost seamlessly with almost no downtime. I don't have time to get bored in Factorio.
Yeah.
Because I'm always doing something that is working towards something.
It's super deceptive because the game makes you think, oh, if I just automate this thing, I won't have to worry about it anymore. And I can go work on the thing I need to work on. Right? So that's how you get these little subtasks that that fill in all this time magically. And then all of those automated things always break for some reason, and they do require attention, and it gives you this just this tree of subtasks.
It's really, really good game design. It's the way that, like, the pacing of a game is so important, and I can't stress that enough. There are so many games out there that have brilliant mechanics, but the chunks, if you break the game down into task reward chunks, are too big. Like, they're too large scale to give me the satisfaction of just sitting down and playing it consistently. There's not many games that do that well. Factorio is a game that does that very, very well. I'm looking forward to future developments. Like, this is a game that's still in early access.
Yeah.
For the fact that it's in early access, like, things like pacing, things like the getting the speed of play right, like the length of play session and the reward systems in place so that players are hooked, is normally a thing that happens after it's feature complete, right? They balance after feature completion. That's kind of the last phase of game design, is making sure everything works well. And I'm sure they've been balancing through the alphas because it's in early access, but it still blows my mind how well they've nailed the pacing in Factorio.
And I think that may be what makes a good early access game, which is another topic that's slightly off topic that we could get back to. But one of the things that might make a good early access game is just the fact that the balance and the pacing are in before release instead of being the last thing that's done, because an unbalanced game is completely unplayable.
Absolutely. You go. Yep.
Yeah. Do you have more to say about Factorio? I was about to change gears and move on to addiction in general, or game addiction in general.
I think I could talk about Factorio for hours. I could talk about the different elements of Factorio. I would love to get into the discussion of playing Factorio properly. I'd also love to get into the discussion of...
Right, but we were trying really hard not to make this just the Factorio show.
We were. So we'll come back to that. We'll come back to Factorio at the end if we've got more time. But let's talk about game addiction in general, and makes games addictive in general.
Yeah, I want to be careful. This isn't a show about game addiction as a psychological problem, right? Yeah. This is a game about what makes a game addictive from a design standpoint. And I want to be careful. The wording could be misleading if we're not careful about being specific. Factorio, we've talked about the sort of unfinished business thing that makes you want to come back to the game. Right? And another game that has that same thing, but is a wildly different game in my mind, is one that I notoriously don't enjoy, and you notoriously do. And you should be the one that talks about it, because I didn't like it.
So Stardew Valley presents a very similar sort of dynamic. And it breaks it down. The reason I loved Stardew Valley was because it gave me that feeling of always having a task, but also completing tasks periodically. So I was constantly getting that Kickstarter of good job, Lolash, you did a thing. But it also gave me cutoff points, right? Stardew Valley was structured really, really well. I think the main issue that you might have had with Stardew Valley was just it's not tutorialized very well. And if you don't have experience in previous sort of in the precursor games, in the Rune Factories, in the in the Harvest Moons, then you don't have that like prior knowledge of where the game is probably going to head.
Well, and it also just didn't like the tasks for me. My brain couldn't care about completing them.
Really?
Yeah, I just didn't, like, none of them made me go, oh, I really want to work on that. And I don't know why. Like, I haven't, and I'm not going to try and process that further because I've done a lot of processing out loud and none of it has come to anything. But I didn't care about the tasks, which is pretty important when the addiction is this sort of task-reward feedback loop.
Yeah, so in Stardew Valley, the task reward system is as simple as, like, the simplest form in Stardew Valley is your farm is dirty, clean it.
Mm-hmm.
There's rocks and trees and stumps and grass everywhere. Get rid of it. And it is amazing how simple, like, that is as a game element. Like, there's this big patch of dirt and it has stuff on it. Make it not have stuff on it. People will spend hours clicking imaginary rocks.
Mm-hmm.
Like hours and hours clicking imaginary rocks. If it's a task and it has an end and like they have a desire to complete that task. I was fortunate enough to get away from Stardew Valley before I got too sucked in. I only played the first 2.5 years of the game. I didn't go deeper than that. But, like, I still wanted to get to the point where the main story ended, and I wanted to explore as much of the mines as I could and do a bunch of fishing and try and complete the collections and in Stardew, because there's a bunch of collection-based stuff, like catch all of the fish and get all of the minerals and harvest all of the different crops and that sort of thing. So, there's Stardew Valley is another game that's potentially very addictive for players who like to have tasks. And the other thing that Stardew Valley did, which is a good thing and a bad thing, depending on how you look at it, is it always gave you more tasks than were possible to complete.
Yep. And that's like...
Factorio...
I think that more tasks than are possible to complete is the difference between making one play session last until the sun comes up and you don't realize what time it is. And when you do shut the game down, you want to come back. Right? There's two different scales. Like, you know, Stardew Valley has night times. And you can leave the game at nighttime. Like, when I get back to my house, it's time for me to go make dinner. And instead of not eating dinner, there is, like, a moment of cutoff and I can escape. But in the back of my mind, I'm coming back to play this game because of the three things I didn't finish today. Right? So it gets you that come back in factor.
It's and this links into like, so when you talk about, so if we break it down, and this is something I'd like to do, is if we were to break down what makes games addictive, which is like the core sort of question that we're asking ourselves and discussing today, you really need to like look at what elements of games. So what are the actual elements of games that do that?
Yeah.
And so far we've addressed the task reward cycle and like the length of that and the pacing of the tasks coming at you, which is really important. So task pacing is important for making an addictive game. We've talked about the, you know, the like blossoming problems, so that problems start small but get bigger, and so you get sucked into something that looks simple but then becomes very complicated, so it sucks up all of your time, which is another good game design element. The next thing that I want to talk about, and this is something that you just raised, which is the come back and play me tomorrow thing, is the concept of time-gated rewards, right?
Yeah.
Which is things like, and we said we were going to talk about...
I almost feel like...
against Lord Blizz.
I almost feel like time-gated rewards needs us to delve into mobile games momentarily.
We'll need to do that as well. I was going to bring up World of Warcraft and sure. the daily system as yep. my example.
Yep.
If you have a task that is gated behind a real time frame, then players have to play regularly.
You set a routine.
You have to come back to the game. Yeah.
Right? You make it like, like my daily routine is I go to school, I go to my classes on that run on Monday, and then I get home at 2 in the afternoon, and I log in for 1 hour and complete 25 daily quests. And then I go and call my friends, and we meet up for dinner. Like, it just becomes yep. part of your daily cycle.
And, like, as streamers, this is something that we can really easily relate to. Like, if I had approached you 6 months ago, and during the first part of your stream, when you were streaming, the second part of your stream, sorry, when you were streaming XCOM 2,
mm-hmm.
XCOM Long War, rather, back when you were playing Long War before XCOM 2 came out, and I was to say, right, in the second half of your stream, let's do a thing. And yeah. I'm just going to say a thing because it could be the greatest thing in the world. But you would feel dirty doing that thing as opposed to doing your regular thing, which was playing XCOM, because that is the routine that you'd gotten into. XCOM Long War was the thing. Even now, like, I remember, and it's broken now because it's been upset for a week.
Yep.
But I remember when you were playing XCOM 2 every afternoon, the first night we played multiplayer Factorio together, and you went from doing, like, Factorio, XCOM 2, Factorio, XCOM 2, then the next day it was, like, Factorio, and I jumped on, and then we looked at the time, and it was, like,
yeah,
nearly time to finish the stream. And you felt dirty. You were like, oh, I've missed XCOM. And we were talking after the stream. And you were like, I can't believe I missed XCOM. Like, yeah. I shouldn't have done that. And then now it's like, XCOM? XCOM?
Yeah, and so it's amazing how easy it is to define a new routine. Right? Because I missed my routine one time, and suddenly I had a new routine. Right? Yep. You know, the routine thing is very powerful, but a game needs more than that because that's easy to break. And I think if we're on the topic of World of Warcraft, this brings up something that is highly rewarding and addictive to me personally. And as I think more about it, I think it's one of the key differences between Stardew Valley and Factorio. And that is progress. Progress is really rewarding to me. So individual tasks have a completion reward cycle. But to me, that's more meaningful and more powerful if completing that task puts progress through Factorio's tech tree. There's a very obvious page of to-do list in the form of a tech tree, and I have visual feedback and confirmation and the game mechanics change because I've made progress. And I'm sure that those mechanics exist in Stardew Valley, and if I say they don't, people will get incredibly upset at me. But they weren't obvious enough to me as a player to get me hooked on completing them. Yeah, and so that's something that...
you go.
That's something that World of Warcraft did, like, painfully well. With leveling up your character, with leveling up your crafting skills, and then, like, right when we were getting capped out on all that stuff, they just put in a big page of achievements, and you can look at your page of achievements, and you can always find a thing to do if you get done with your daily quests and still have 10 minutes.
Yeah. On the point of Stardew Valley had two progression systems,
mm-hmm.
Neither of which were really explained well, which is one of the things I would have liked to see explained a little bit better in the game, and that was you had a experience per task system, so as you did a task more, you became more skilled, and if you hit breakpoints, you got, like, talents, which improved certain aspects of that task. So if you leveled your mining to level 5, you could either get bonus ore or bonus gems and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And it also has the collection window, which is very much the achievement. Collect all of the things. And every person is wired a little bit differently and sees those progressions in different ways. Like, I am not somebody who has to collect all the collectibles. Like, that's not something that in my brain, doesn't go, ooh, 300
yeah.
warg furs. I need to collect all of those different types of warg fur. I don't do that. But my brain is definitely a shiny new level and a new stat point. I have to get those. Stardew Valley hits both of those itches. Unfortunately, neither of them are really explained very well, which
sort of
detracts from the progression system.
Yeah, I did get... Yeah, I need the game to tell me I've been a good boy. Right? That works for me. It just, like, I want a big celebration that I've leveled up. And, Stardew Valley didn't celebrate it hard enough for me. there were a couple of things. Like, I realized quickly that finding new mine levels was a thing. And that started to be a task that I cared about before I put the game down. That bit of progress, that feeling that you made something real and lasting, which are weird words to say, because it's a virtual world that doesn't matter. But, like, that feeling, you can trick your brain into having it in a virtual world, and it feels pretty good. And it makes you want to come back and play. And I think that games that people classify as addictive do that really well.
Yeah. Speaking on games that have progression systems and are addictive, I am a little scared about a new game that I've been playing, which a lot of people have been playing, called Enter the Gungeon. Lama, what do you know about Enter the Gungeon?
I have seen... Yeah, I've seen, like, the Steam page and their, like, PR pitch for the game, and it looks... on that surface level, it looks like it would be a very entertaining sort of take on the Binding of Isaac-style roguelike. I mean, it looks like a well-done roguelike game, but and I think that those games, even though each playthrough is fresh and you start with nothing, they do a really good job of the progression feeling with unlockables, right? Which is
so
a different type of
talk
progression.
About next, I've been playing Into the Gungeon. I've clocked up a few hours since the launch. And have experienced the game. I'm reasonably good at it. I haven't beaten it yet. I have gotten down to the final level and seen the final boss and gotten my puny weakling self beaten into a bloody pulp. But the game is really good for unlocks. Like, when I was playing it, I would look at what I was achieving every run and then be like, I'm just going to hit the quick restart button and do another run, because it has multiple layers of unlocks. It has multiple different NPCs that you can unlock, and it has multiple different, like, unlockable items that you can get in different ways by achieving things or by unlocking them with credits that you get for beating certain bosses and things like that. I'm not going to go into too much detail because it's fairly new and people probably want to learn those sorts of things by themselves. But that concept of unlockables, of unlockable power, even if it's not immediately applied, the fact that you are getting something new that could surprise you in the future, even that is enough to trigger that. I just want to get that one thing unlocked, which, like, it blows my mind.
The weakness of unlockable addiction compared to the other things that we've been talking about is that it ends. There's a cutoff where you've unlocked all of the things. So, like, FTL is a wonderfully designed, beautiful game. And you unlock the different ships. And once you have unlocked all of the different ships, you've unlocked all the ships. And if that was what kept you coming back to play, was just the unlock, then you're done. And you don't play that game anymore.
Yeah. Yeah. That's a thing.
Yeah. So, you know, it compares, like, it compares to daily quests in a way that, like, daily quests can keep you coming back forever, if that's what motivates you, where unlockables, eventually you unlock them all, unless the developers are consistently adding new ones.
Yeah. Yeah, which is a problem. The thing is that with the unlockables, like, if there's enough of them,
mm-hmm.
if the unlockables can get you into routine and have you playing a game consistently for a long time, they can really suck up your playtime.
It's a game with unlockables for me that is infinitely like, it has the potential for infinite addiction because they just keep adding unlockables. Hearthstone. They, yeah. like, you know, if you're not dropping hundreds of dollars on card packs, which, you know, is a perfectly viable way to play that game, and you're trying to unlock everything through their daily quest system and gold and arenas and, like, if you're trying to do, like, a free-to-play unlock... You would have to play a lot of hours every day to keep up with their rate of expansions. And just, you know, just releasing 100 new cards every few months keeps unlockables as a goal that can keep you addicted forever. Like, just forever.
Well, for as long as they produce the games.
Yeah.
We can't touch on... what makes games addictive, though, without talking about the concept of mobile games.
Yeah.
And the guys at Roundtable Podcast, who I have a lot of respect for, I think they recently did a segment on mobile gaming and monetization of mobile games. And they were looking into, like, how much money was being made and by what percentage of players of a particular game were making that money. And the statistics were really shocking. I don't have them handy, but you should definitely, like, if you're interested in looking at some of those statistics, you can find them over on the Roundtable Podcast. I think it was from, like, 2 weeks ago from today. So that would be, like, back on the 20-somethingth. 20-somethingth of March... in 2016, if you're watching this in, like, 2040 or something, when I'm old and gray or dead.
Mm-hmm.
But if YouTube's still around at that point. But mobile games are specifically, like, okay, I'm going to set forth my opinion here. This is my opinion. This doesn't necessarily reflect the opinion of Llama. I'm sure he'll agree or disagree with me in just a moment. I find mobile game developers to be almost malicious in the way they design their games. Because when you look at the statistics of where the money comes from on the monetization of those addictive styles of games, it comes from a few individuals who have addictive personalities who get sucked into them and spend thousands of dollars on a game that they can play for free. And... like, that, like, the topic I want to hit on, and it's a bit heavy,
mm-hmm.
when it comes to, like, what makes games addictive, is how dangerous that is when developers have become so good at making them.
Yeah, and I think, like, there's an easy place to dive off into being a responsible game dev, and using your power for good and not for evil. You know, because if you learn about, if gaming has been tuning this for decades and will continue to tune, like, human brain engagement, like, that's their business, that's how they make their money, right? And they need to continue making money. That's, you know, it's a feedback loop that makes a ton of sense. And there's a bit of a moral responsibility to not take advantage of people.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Right, so
mobile games...
Yeah, go ahead.
I was going to say mobile games hit the two, I think, most important aspects of an addictive game, which is come back and play me later, and, oh, you did a thing, here's a shiny reward. those are the two aspects of mobile gameplay that really, and I think in general, they're the two aspects of gameplay that make a game truly addictive, is come back and play me later syndrome, and ooh, you did a thing, here's a shiny syndrome. If we break it down into like the two raw categories, and mobile games focus on both, right? Yeah. It's pretty crazy.
Yeah, and it's a dangerous topic to start to talk about, but I think it's probably an important one. And I think there are very responsible developers who do it right and fairly. And I think Hearthstone is a good example of, it's a freemium system, right? You can play that game for free. I have spent, I think, $2 ever on Hearthstone, and I have a lot of cards because I used to play it really frequently. And, you know, that they make that part available, and then they are still making money because you do want to occasionally give them a few dollars. And I think that they've done it in a very responsible fashion, where it's really easy to start pushing those systems into a place where people think they're playing a free game and are making many, many microtransactions, and each time they're like, it's just a dollar. And like, I mean, I don't want to say that there are people who don't realize how much money they're spending, because I don't know. Maybe each of those people who spent thousands and thousands of dollars on a dumb free mobile game, like, maybe they knew exactly what they were doing and they did it on purpose and they're very happy with their purchases. But I feel like it would be very easy to trick people. And to get them to not, just like Factorio tricks me with the clock, I think it's very easy to trick people with their wallet as well. And they'd look down and they'd go, oh my gosh, I just spent $300. I thought I had spent $50. The same way I look down and say, hey, I've been playing this for about an hour and a half. Oh my goodness, it's 9 a.m. and I haven't slept. Like, I think that you can do the same thing.
The human brain, there's a great TED Talk. I don't know if you watch TED Talks, Lara.
Yeah, yeah.
They're basically keynote speakers. If anybody who's watching the podcast hasn't heard of TED Talks, go up to the window. Like, once you finish watching the podcast on YouTube, go up to the window above YouTube, type in TED Talks, and just start, like, doing the old YouTube, like, journey through TED Talks. You'll learn some really interesting things. But
if you value your time, it can be dangerous. Yeah. You can lose a lot of hours into like, just interesting, like, every topic possible. Yeah.
The topic I want to bring up is a talk that was done by a guy named Apollo Robbins, who you might have heard of. You might have even seen his TED Talk. And he was a pickpocket for many, many years, and he mastered the art of capturing human attention, so that he could do things like steal people's wallets and watches right from underneath their noses. And he does a TED Talk with an actual demonstration to show you how easy it is. And he describes human attention in probably the most interesting way I've ever heard it described. And he does a great job of describing it, but I will paraphrase and try and describe it as best I can here. He says that human attention is like a security guard in your brain, right? And he's got all sorts of fancy equipment to listen and look, and he's got files behind him so he can, that's all your memories. But the problem is that I just knocked over my bottle. The problem is, he calls him Frank. Frank can only do one thing at a time. He can only be looking or searching through the memory banks or listening. Frank is one man. Frank can do one thing at a time. And if Frank is focused on a task, then everything else is just sort of handled autonomously by the system. It's not, you're not paying attention. Like, if Frank's not paying attention, you're seeing it, you're hearing it, but you're not actually seeing or hearing it while he's digging through a memory. And I think that is where things like microtransactions in mobile games are so dangerous, because you're playing the game and, you know, you're trying to build a thing, or I don't play mobile games because, frankly, I find them garbage, but that's personal opinion. But, you know, you're trying to build a thing and it's like, you can build this thing faster for 55 cents. And you're like, brilliant, I'm going to build that faster for 55 cents. And you're not thinking, I'm spending 55 cents. You're thinking, I'm going to build that faster, because that's what your brain's focusing on.
Yeah.
And I think that, and that's the same thing with all addictive games, and anything that captures your attention and makes you lose track is that process. Like in Factorio, when we're trying to design a module and cram it into as small a space as possible, our brain isn't thinking, oh, time is ticking by. Our brain is simply thinking, how do I remove that square of empty space? I've got to be able to fit something there.
And I think your brain is very good at shifting to other tasks momentarily. Like, as soon as it has free space, you know, it like, my brain is trained to read Twitch chat and look at the clock. Anytime, like, it has a few free cycles, it goes and checks up on those things. And the thing about, like, Factorio specifically is that it puts things in the buffer for free cycles also, right? So so I'm working on my module, and when I have free cycles, I look at the bus to make sure copper's still flowing instead of looking at my clock and my chat. it has I have things backloaded into the buffer so that I don't get to use my free cycles for maintaining, like, all of the things that they usually maintain.
When I'm playing Factorio on stream, and I'm probably going to stop streaming it soon, not because I don't enjoy the game, but because A, I don't want to burn out on it, and B, I'm really bad at playing Factorio and being a streamer.
Yeah.
Because when I get focused on a design task or a build task,
yep,
I get focused on that task, and I won't talk to my chat for 5 minutes. Like, I'm terrible. Which is why I've enjoyed playing it with you, because at least with you, you know, we are having a conversation and there are two of us looking at one chat. So,
well, that's, yeah. And that's one of the things, like, I started to try really hard toward the most recent bits of Factorio. Like, I made a more conscious effort to check chat. But that's also the thing about streaming with multiplayer in your ear, is it's much too easy to give the multiplayer, those other people that have their voice in your ear, your attention instead of chat, because chat takes a little bit more effort. You have to read and you have to, like, cope with the conversation delay. And so, you know, it's really hard to check chat during a multiplayer stream, which is one of the reasons I tend to avoid them in general. Because I think it makes me a worse streamer. Because, I mean, there are lots of streams that don't interact with chat at all and are very entertaining streams. But that's not what I want to do in my channel.
No, I'm the same. Which is why I'm thinking about moving away from... I can't believe I'm saying this, but thinking about moving away from Factorio. Just because I know that it...
Go ahead.
Yeah. I know that it negatively impacts on my ability as a streamer.
Yeah.
Like, I pride myself on chat interaction, and that's very hard to do when all I can see is the latest string of conveyor belt that I've just laid. So
let's talk about one more turn syndrome, which is a very common thing. Like, if you're going to talk about things that make games addictive, the one more turn thing is definitely something that needs to be addressed, because it doesn't have that sort of overload factor, right? There are clear moments where you are done with a thing and can stop, right? A turn is a moment when you're done with a thing and can stop. And then sometimes you just don't. So what is it, do you think, that causes the next turn to be so attractive that you ignore your own mental flag where you said, at the end of this turn, I need to get up?
So I think that comes back to the whole concept of game pacing. I'm going to use Civilization as an example, because I think Civilization is the greatest example of one more turn.
It's the iconic one more turn game.
Yep. So when I'm playing Civilization and I start out and I have my one city, right? At the very start of the game, I don't have one more turn syndrome. I don't have it. I can stop in the first 20, 30 turns. Not a problem. The city doesn't have any real direction at this point. I might have built one wonder. Like, it doesn't... There's no substance to what I'm doing. There's no clear-cut goals or objectives that I've set for myself at that point in the game. Similarly, at turn 400, when I'm four times the size of my nearest rival and am steamrolling my way over the map, I can quit mid-turn, like, do an attack and be like, eh, I'm done with this game, because I no longer have one more turn syndrome. I think one more turn syndrome comes when you hit the meat of the game. Your city is expanding. You're sending out new colonists. You're choosing targets to attack. You're picking the researchers that you're going to be doing. And all of those things are overlapping tasks that don't happen all at once and don't give you a clear cutoff. Like, how often in a game of Civ does your tech end, you don't want to attack anybody, you don't have any cities growing, you don't have any building production choices to make, you don't have any attacks coming your way, you don't have any exploration to do, you simply end a turn and have nothing to do. Like, that just doesn't happen in Civilization.
Right.
I think that comes down to very clever pacing again. I think it's a really great... like balance of game design where they've been able to create consistently over the course of the last, what, 15 years?
Yeah.
These 4X games that do that. So.
So the difference is that one turn doesn't accomplish a task. It feels like turns should give you exit points, but what happens is if a task takes 10 turns, over the course of 10 turns, another task crops up 7 turns in. And then suddenly you're 3 turns along that second task, and you can't quit at the end of the first task, because you have another one that has... And that sort of, like, overlapping tasks is the key.
And until you hit critical mass in a game of, like, a 4X game like Civilization, until you hit that point where you're like, right, the game's won, it only grows exponentially, because you're only gaining more ground, gaining more cities, speeding up production, speeding up science. Things are just happening rapidly, rapidly, rapidly. And you're growing and growing and growing, and you're making more and more decisions as the game progresses. One of the reasons I'm super excited for Stellaris is that paradigm in the early game, the whole concept of, you know, having to constantly make decisions in the early game to get me hooked before we get into the grand strategy elements. So.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and as the game scales up, I think there's a very careful balance also where you don't want to overwhelm, right? Because if I have overlapping tasks and their number is always 2 or 3 and they come in about the same pace I clear them, I hit this stride in this rhythm and I can't ever stop because, oh, I just need to finish the thing. And then the next thing feels just as important as the thing I've been working on and I just need to finish the thing. But sometimes when I get to a point in a game where it hands me 15 tasks at once, I go, oh, I don't have time to sort through these and decide which one to do next. I can turn this off now and come back and sort through them tomorrow. And that's the danger in like as the 4X games scale up, as your empire scales up, and as you're interacting with more pieces, you have this chance of that bloat overwhelming your brain, and your brain like is very good at saying, no, I can't do that right now. I need to get some sleep and come back with fresh eyes and I'll put this down.
Yeah, well, possibly.
For me,
that doesn't happen very often.
For me, that like I recognize that overwhelmed feeling, and maybe I get to it a little more easily than you do.
Yeah, I typically don't find myself overwhelmed by games. There will be times where I will get a bunch of things that I need to do in a game, and just be like, I'll come back to that next time.
Yeah.
Like, it gives me... I choose that as a jumping off point, because then I know when I'm excited to play the game again and come back, I'll have lots of things to do, which is kind of like fluffing myself for my next game. It's like, okay, you're going to have all of these things to do. Go away and do that thing that you have to do, because
PSA, if you don't understand what he just said, get the meaning from context, not from Google.
Yes.
For our family-friendly viewers, don't look that up.
I thought that was just subtle enough that it would
Right, it's perfectly safe unless someone is curious where that phrase comes from. Which is why don't be curious. If you choose to not be,
don't be curious.
Don't go be.
Yeah, that's a much better idea. I'm going to move into non-digital media here for a second, because I'm the same with books, right? Mm-hmm. If like the pacing, I keep coming back to it, but I seriously think it's the most critical part of a game is the pacing. Because if a book is paced well, like if there are things happening in a book consistently, I will pick it up and read it from start to finish. A perfect example is back when I was 13, a wee lad, 15 odd years ago, my brother gave me a third edition Lord of the Rings trilogy hardback for Christmas. Big, bulky, heavy thing. I didn't know what it was when he gave it to me in its wrapping, because it didn't look like a book, I'll tell you that much. It was like this thick and this huge. It had all the appendices and everything, you know, really, really nice book, which I still own. I picked that up. I started reading it Christmas morning. My family didn't see me until Boxing Day night, because I was just reading, and then I slept for 4 hours, and then I got up and kept reading because I was so engrossed in the book. And the pacing was really, really good, because J.R.R. Tolkien is an amazing, or was an amazing author. So like that whole concept of presenting players with a challenge, and you know, we've looked at a lot of games that do that really well, and I don't want to like, you know, go super negative or anything, but can you think of games that have not paced well?
What?
Like the mechanics and everything felt really good.
I don't know.
Didn't pace itself well.
Yeah, I don't. I like this. The example that comes to mind isn't a critical one. This isn't a negative thing. It's just that the game is set up to be, it's not set up to be this kind of addictive game. And I think it's because it brings you back for the storyline, and the campaign is short enough that you can just play to finish the campaign, and it doesn't need to keep you addicted and sitting in the chair for 6 hours. And it's just, it's a different design decision. I wouldn't say it's a worse one, and I wouldn't say it's a problem with pacing. But XCOM, the entire XCOM series, has really easy exit points. You finish, like, the transition from strategy to tactical to strategy to tactical gives you an exit point when you need one. If, like, when the next mission pops up on the strategy layer, you go, I'm not going on this mission right now. I need to go do other things with my life. And it gives you these clean exit points. It's a brilliantly designed game, it's really fun to play, and it offers you clean exit points and doesn't keep you stuck to your seat. Sort of, like, if we use the word addiction, that's often negative, right? And we're praising all these games for addicting us so well, because we like it. but there's some merit to, like, I really enjoy that this game lets me leave and be a responsible adult when I want.
And that's I was hoping you'd go to that as an example, actually. That wasn't scripted for anybody who's watching. I just asked him that question blind. I wanted to talk about that, because a game doesn't have to be addictive to be good and make you want to play it again.
Right, and often being addictive is malicious on the... I mean, I don't want to say... Like, going back to mobile games being malicious, I never really responded to that when you gave me a chance to agree or disagree. Like, it's really easy to argue that it's not their fault. They just did a thing that made money, and then they did the thing that made money better, and then they did the thing that made money better. And maybe it is their fault that they never checked in with their moral compass to see if they were being evil yet. But, like, I can see how that cycle can build. And they're just doing the thing that keeps bringing in more money, and they're ignoring moral implications, which is probably amoral or immoral.
Immoral, yeah.
But, you know, that, like, I don't remember where I started this thought.
Mobile games.
What was your question before that? Because I digressed into back into mobile.
Games don't have to be addictive to be good and
right.
fun to and, play oh, and want you to come back.
And my corollary was sometimes the addictive aspect is a bad thing. And it's not a good feature of the game. You're not addicted because it's fun. You're addicted because it's addictive and not actually even a good game.
Yeah. I think, like, there are some really great non-core game experiences of that, particularly on mobile devices. There are some really, like, awful games. When you look at the, like, top 20 earners for mobile games, some of them are... not even games?
Yeah.
Like, I...
Yeah.
I don't know.
It's actually... Yeah, I mean... And how many of them are clones? Like, I don't want to get into a long discussion of mobile games, but my 4-year-old has downloaded 8,000 free versions of Temple Run with different paint on them. And that's a bit of hyperbole. The number 8,000 is a bit of hyperbole. But I can think of 4 right now, just off the top of my head. He has a Bugs Bunny one, and a Minions one, and actual Temple Run. And I think the Bugs Bunny one has, like, a separate, like, the same IP even. There's a separate game where he's the bird instead of the rabbit. Like... And they're all the same game. You just swipe left or right to run in different lanes down the thing. And, like, that level of just cloning a game mechanic to put more free-to-play buttons in front of a 4-year-old, it's hard to say that's not evil. It's definitely impossible to say that that is compelling creative game design.
It's not. Like, it just isn't.
Yeah.
So I just want to say something, which most people know anyway, but I want to say it because I would like it to be recorded on the podcast. My stance on current gaming media and game design is I will always be brutally honest, which is tricky at times because sometimes I say things that are inflammatory, and they're always my own opinion, but I think that as somebody in games media, even as somebody who is a small-time Twitch streamer who doesn't do YouTube and doesn't do any kind of formal game reviews or anything like that, I still feel a little bit of responsibility when it comes to, like, having a stance on these sorts of topics, because at the end of the day, like, I might service a very small community, but I still service the community, and I would hope that my opinion on these sorts of things actually matters. And if one person gets informed and can make their own decision about these, like, trickier topics because they've listened to our podcast, Llama, like, that's a huge thing. I think that it's... These sorts of questions are tricky because there are pitfalls, right? You don't... Like,
well,
Twitch streamer, we don't want to badmouth
game
designers because we rely on them giving us things so that we can do our jobs. But I still think mobile developers are evil.
I don't, my reason for avoiding the mobile topic isn't that it's inflammatory, it's that I don't really have anything to add. Everybody knows that it's shady to trick people into giving you their money. And I don't know what compelling thing I have to add to that conversation. I don't have a solution other than, like, yeah, obviously don't download these things. Like, just, but you already know that because you can see through the veneer, and, like, I don't know that I need to tell people. Like, this has been around long enough that everybody knows that it's evil and garbage. Except maybe everybody doesn't know because they're still making lots of money. I don't know. But our audience probably aren't the people that they're making money from.
No, I would say so. I think our audience are all intelligent, well-adjusted, mostly post 18-year-old.
Yeah, I'd be careful. I'd be careful with intelligent, because implying that anyone who gets addicted to and accidentally pays a bunch of money to a mobile game is unintelligent, I don't know that that's super fair. But our audience are gamers, and they are familiar with good games and can make decisions based on, this game isn't actually good, it's just addictive. If one of those little addiction engines is the first thing you've ever played, and you don't have any experience with good games, it might be easier for that to trick you, whether or not you're an intelligent human being.
Yeah, true. Thanks, Devious Verbal. Right, so I love that. I love that comment. So yeah, I think, look, we've talked a fair bit about gaming addiction. I think we've narrowed it down to like a few core principles about what makes a game addictive. And I think we've hit both sides of the coin as well when it comes to like addictive games aren't necessarily a bad thing. Like, you can design an addictive game without being malicious, but you can also use, with great power
comes great responsibility. Thanks, right? Spider-Man.
You're a game developer, and you are using psychological trickery to increase playtime or increase enjoyment in a game. That's fine, as long as it's not going to cause detrimental effects. And I think microtransactions and monetization of these sorts of mechanics, particularly like time-gated content, is the big thing for mobile devices, right?
Yep.
Is time-gated content is hidden behind a paywall, and you can pay to speed things up. Using those sorts of systems is bad. And like, if I ever see a video game that has a time-gated system that is like beatable by microtransaction, I just won't play it. Like, just won't, out of principle, because...
Yeah, I don't think there's any excuse for that as a game mechanic. It's not a game mechanic. And it has no place in a game that takes itself seriously as, like, a game that is art, that is well-designed. The mechanic of, you've already played for 15 minutes, do you want to buy a 15 more minutes, or do you want to wait? That's not a game mechanic. It's a money grab mechanic. But microtransactions can be done responsibly. And that's a grayer area. Right? I think the time gate, like, you have 5 lives and you have to wait for 30 minutes to get a new life, that's a money grab. But I think that microtransactions can be a business model that can be done responsibly. And I keep coming back to the only example I can think of that's done it, which is Hearthstone. Like, they use microtransactions, you buy card packs, and I feel like they've been very responsible about how it's implemented, very fair to players who don't want to spend that money, and very fair to players who do want to spend that money. And they've made it, they've done that microtransaction system in a way that redeems the entire thing to me. Like, it makes it so that I believe it can be done responsibly because of that one game.
Yeah, and there are examples of microtransactions. Like, people hear microtransaction, this is very similar to the DLC conversation we had.
The word is just dirty. Months ago. Undeservedly.
Yeah. Like, microtransactions is a dirty word. If you hear microtransactions, you immediately are like, whoa. And that's because, probably pulling a statistic out of my derriere, like 90% of microtransaction implementation is garbage. Is purely there to like suck money out of, like, just try and just suck money out of the system. There are good examples of microtransactions, and I don't think microtransactions should be a dirty word, in the same way that DLC should not be a dirty word, in the same way that RNG should not be a dirty word.
We
covered both of those topics in the past. But it's, I think, like...
Yeah. So, We've missed one major aspect of addiction, right? We've talked about completing a task, getting a dopamine reward. We've talked about making progress, getting a dopamine reward. We've talked about how those relate to different game formats. But we haven't talked about social. And I think, like, if we want to come back to the big granddaddy of game addiction, which is World of Warcraft, it has all of the things, right? It has creating a routine with daily quests. It has progression with leveling and crafting and achievement systems. It has progression with the dungeon systems, even. It has, it has that you gain new tasks while doing a task, and you're in, like, that task loop. And additionally, it has my friends are there, and I want to log in to see my friends, which isn't something that we've talked about yet today.
Yeah, and there's not a lot that can be said about it. It's a perfect point, right? Is that a game that allows you to connect with other like-minded people is always going to be more successful than a game that you play completely solo. Assuming you're connecting with like-minded people and can interact with them in a socially responsible and adult manner, if you're an adult.
And let me,
a childish manner if you're a child.
Let me clarify that I haven't played World of Warcraft in 4 years? 3 years?
Yeah.
And so anything I say about World of Warcraft is three-year-old data. But it's a good example in this gaming addiction, like all of those experiences 3 years ago are a good example of the things we've been talking about. And I don't know the current state of the game, and Twitch chat is telling me that I should speak in the past tense more clearly, and I want to be clear that I am in the past tense. But for me, like one of the biggest things about my investment in World of Warcraft when that was the thing I was doing was that I had this group of friends, and I think Satori's in the chat right now. He was part of that core raiding group, and one of the few people that didn't live close enough to me to go out for pizza after raid night. And that, like that game bled over so hard into real life that it was almost hard to me to think of it as an addiction in the sense that it negatively impacts your health, which is like the psychological definition of addiction. Because my addiction to World of Warcraft positively impacted my social health. And it gave me a good thing to do with friends that I would then see in the real... Like, we would get done with our 10-man raid, and 8 of the people in the raid would meet up at the pizza place and debrief the raid and hang out and eat pizza and have a great time. And that social aspect was so important to keeping me in that game.
Yeah, I used to do a big spit roast once a month with my raiding guild. We'd all get together and roast a whole hog.
Yeah.
On a rotisserie over an open fire and just sit around and drink beer and talk about WoW. As you do when you meet with WoW players in real life, you just talk about World of Warcraft.
And if we that group of friends still hits a critical mass where we relive those stories, like when if enough of us get in the room. That's our shared experience. Just like if you get in the same room with your college dorm mates, you start talking about your college shenanigans. Like that group of people, if you get 4 or 5 of them in the same room, do you remember that time in World of Warcraft? Is what we talk about.
Yeah.
And so that social aspect is super key. And I don't know a game that's done the social aspect that well for me. And if you have other examples in that space, I'd love to add them to the discussion, but I don't, that's the only one I have.
Well, I think MMOs are the big, like all MMOs are they have the integrated social networking, as part of their whole design. As a Twitch streamer, we are consistently exposed to communities, in a way that you don't get as just a regular gamer,
like
because we played a variety of different games and we stream them, and like when we play a single player game, we're not playing a single player game, we're playing a single player game with 100 people hanging out with us, and so we have these unusual shared experience which makes even a single player game have that social element for us on a different level. But there was one other point I wanted to make, and I mentioned this really early on, I'm going to go on a bit of a lolash rant here, Llama.
All right. I think it's time that we can drop our main topic and hit anything we wanted to rant about for the last 15 minutes of the cast.
Okay. I'm going to have a little bit of a rant, a little bit of a rage. I'm going to have a little bit of a complain and whinge and whine about people. You know who you are. Who think there is only one way to play a sandbox game.
Yeah.
Okay, all right. Now, I'm not saying that I don't appreciate input. I'm not saying that I don't appreciate advice or even pretty pictures of other people's bases. But the next time somebody says to me while I am playing Factorio or Minecraft or Terraria or any of those styles of game, the next time somebody says, you're doing it wrong, I swear to God, I'm going to find a fish and slap them with it. Like, I'm sorry.
So, this...
I'm sorry.
This rant, I agree with, and it was precipitated today specifically. I was looking for footage, because I knew we were going to talk about Factorio. I was looking for footage to put on the screen for Factorio, and the top playlist was a proper playthrough, implying that there's like only one way to Factorio right, and those words set my teeth on edge. Like, I just no. And I think Factorio has some aspects that lend it to that. Like, it drives people in the direction of there's one right way to do it, because like, the game, the underpinnings are about efficiency. And if I can do something more efficiently, I can then equate that to more correctly. And then I can tell everyone else that they're wrong because I was more efficient. And I have defined this very narrow definition of correct. And the shame in a sandbox game, the shame about defining this very narrow definition of correct is you completely squelch creativity. And there's so much room in Factorio for creative designs that should be explored. And that's, like, the game I want to play is a game where you explore creative designs, not a game where I do the one most efficient thing that people have already discovered. That's not what I want to do, and you can't tell me that that's what I should do because you're dumb and wrong.
So Llama just stole my whole shtick. I was gonna rant about Llama.
I'm sorry. I feel identically to you, and I'm sorry. You should shtick again. I apologize.
No, I'm not gonna shtick because you voiced it very eloquently. I think the main issue, and I said this specifically, sandbox games. The main issue is people think. Like, there are two distinct courts when it comes to sandbox games. Designers and optimizers. Mm-hmm. They're the two distinct courts. You have people who want to experiment and design and make pretty things, and like in Minecraft, they're the guys who build those huge big mega structures that are all intricate and pretty and beautiful. And then you have the guys who strip mine big huge blocks in the ground with no, like, because that's the most optimal way to shift the most stone so that I can smelt it and turn it into whatever I want to smelt it into. That's the two camps. And the problem is, for me personally, I don't fall into either.
Right.
I sit smack bang in the middle. I like to go for this weird middle ground that people just don't seem to understand. Because on one side, you have the people going, no, you can do that more efficiently. And on the other side, you've got the people going, oh, but it's got that little pimple there and the underground belt's sort of intertwining and it's not symmetrical. And their brain just, like, looks out their ears, right?
Yep.
So, sandbox games are one of those games where I can't watch, like, I don't know how you guys do it. I don't know how you guys watch me and Llama play Factorio, because I can't watch sandbox games. Even when I'm watching Llama, like when I was driving home from Perth the other night and you were playing, I was watching you and I'm like, I could do that better.
Yeah.
I could fix that. And I can't do it.
I'm glad you said that, because that's the opposite side of the rant, right? The rant is, don't tell people you could do it better. But that doesn't mean we don't understand the impulse.
Yeah.
That doesn't mean that, like, when I look at something, I don't immediately think, oh, I can think of a design. I'm trying very actively to avoid the word better, right? I can think of a design that I would use that has these benefits over that design, right? And when your design has only benefits over the design you're looking at, it's really hard to avoid the impulse to say that the thing they're doing is wrong. But remind yourself that the thing they're doing is learning. And if you hand them all the best designs, you ruined the game. They didn't get to learn. And you ruined their game.
Llama, there's an age-old adage. Which I think is very appropriate here. If you teach a man to fish, he'll yep. eat for a lifetime. But if yep. you give a man a fish, he will only eat once. If I learn how the systems interact in a game, I will be able to use them more efficiently and do weird things that other people will never think of because they don't have my brain.
Mm-hmm.
But if you give me all of those designs and I have no idea why or how they work, then I haven't solved that problem myself. I haven't thought right. through all of the angles, so and, I can't come up with anything new.
And if I've never experienced the problem that inspired your design, and you just give it to me so I avoid that problem entirely, I lost an important chunk of the game. Like, that's the game I'm playing, is having the problem and fixing the problem. I'm not playing Launch the Rocket.
I'm sorry, there's a comment in chat.
if you teach Loash to fish, he will smack you with a fish. The other my other favorite version of that quote is, if you build a man a fire, he'll be warm for a night. If you light a man on fire, he'll be warm for the rest of his life.
Oh dear.
Oh, Heoric just did the same thing in chat. I promise I started that before I looked at chat. I know if you're watching the show, the delay has it in the wrong order.
Yeah. Oh. I can confirm as somebody who is getting the chat and the video live that Llama started that before Heoric did the thing.
Great minds though, Heoric. You and me, great minds.
We have about 5 minutes left. Do you have anything you're looking forward to coming up, or anything else that you have played or wanted to play?
So we, you know, this has been about addiction, and I think that my addiction to Factorio was very tech tree based. Yep. And now that I have launched a rocket, I feel freedom. And
freedom.
The next game I really want to play that I've been putting off for a long time is RimWorld.
Uh-huh.
I think it's a game that I like. It's well known. It's been out for a really long time. Well, not out. It's been in early access, and people have been playing it for a really long time, and it's still under development. And I haven't ever given it a few weeks of airtime on my channel and airtime in my mental game space. And that's the next thing I'm ready to tackle.
I think you'll be thoroughly pleased with the game. It's just hit another update. RimWorld, for those who don't know, is a science fiction colony management simulator. Graphics similar to Prison Architect. Game concept similar to Dwarf Fortress. You have a bunch of colonists with a bunch of starting stuff.
I think even directly inspired by Dwarf Fortress?
It was directly inspired by Dwarf Fortress, yeah. But they've just had a new alpha that launched like yesterday or the day before. Really recently. I think it was yesterday. Alpha 13 has just come out, which has added a bunch of new systems to the game, including like relationships. Now your colonists will fall in love and get married and get divorced and hate each other and love each other and all of those sorts of things. And you have mothers and fathers and daughters and stuff like that, which is interesting. I've not played Alpha 13 yet, so I don't know about stability or like how much has been added to the game, whether it's still balanced. But I used to have a lot of fun playing on Alpha 12. I played a bunch of it on stream. I think you'll love it. And I'll probably come along and
Yeah, I think that's one that's dangerous because there are lots of people who know it better than me, and I'm going to have to be a little bit vigilant about, I'm still learning, please let me learn. Like, I'm worried that RimWorld is going to have that Factorio element, but I still, like, I'm super excited to learn it on stream.
Yeah, it's a similar concept in that it is a very sandbox-based game. You know, you're given a set of simple rules and raw material and told...
Right. And it's
do something.
It's going to get complex, and I'm going to have questions about how the interface works, and I'm going to have questions about interactions between items. And when I ask those questions, it's very hard to toe the line that exists in my brain and not yours about how much answer I want so that I can still feel like I'm learning the game. Like, I understand that that's hard, and that's fine. It's a place where I'm going to live. I want to respond to a question because virtual reality is all releasing this month. Like, all of the things are coming out very soon. And if we're talking about game addiction today, Sorcerer Rob's question about VR, I think, is one... I don't have a lot of experience with it, so my answer is going to be brief, but I do want to answer it.
Yeah, I think that's a great question.
I think the immersion of VR, if done well and immersively, will make it way easier to do all of the things we've already talked about around game addiction. I think it'll be easier to implement those things with the extra immersion of VR. I think you have, like, one level deeper access to the brain, and you can trigger all of the systems with lower level switches. And so, yeah, I think that VR will probably produce very addictive experiences.
I recently watched a video vlog by Total Biscuit. He recently released a video about his experiences with VR so far. Mm-hmm. And he also talked about them on his most recent co-optional podcast. And Total Biscuit is a man who I trust implicitly when it comes to his opinion. I feel like he is the single least biased, least, like... likely to, let's put it this way, I don't think he would ever do anything that would like breach his principles, his moral compass, for like money. He's just not that dude, right? And he was talking about his experience with the HTC Vive in particular when it comes to sensitivity and like the reality of motion tracking, like the concept of control within VR systems. And he was saying that the VR systems, this is like anecdotal, this is, you know, not from personal experience, but he was saying that the VR systems for the HTC Vive, like the tracking system and the controllers that you use, were so accurate that without using the frontal camera on his headset, when he was in like full VR mode, he could reach out and grab them with 100% accuracy, just because of the tracking system.
I saw the same thing.
That accurate.
I saw the same thing this morning. He went on to say that if he had the dexterity to juggle regular objects, he could probably juggle the controllers.
Which scares me. When it comes to virtual reality, if you can make the virtual world that have tracking that precise, so that objects look and feel. Because, I mean, looking, visually, graphically, we can reproduce an almost photorealistic scene. Like, our technology is getting to the point where we can almost render a game in photorealism. We're not far off. A couple of generations of graphics cards will be there. The scary thing is, when we have photorealistic scenes and one-to-one perfect tracking on your head and your controls, VR is going to be very dangerous when it comes to addiction, I think.
Yeah, well, and
because it just...
You know, the easy, like, slippery slope to go down is, like, if you think of the holodeck as it exists in Star Trek, like, there, you just wouldn't leave. You just wouldn't. And VR isn't that, but it's one step toward that. And, like, yeah, super, like, it lower level access to the brain, better toggles on the addiction switches. Super scary.
The Matrix is coming. Prepare yourselves.
So I answered what I'm playing next. What are you looking forward to other than Stellaris is in? I know, was that what you were going to say? I should just let you say it.
Solaris is in a month.
Yeah.
A month
so,
today.
So
for me, because today is the ninth for me.
In between there, in that next month, what are you going to do to tide the time till Stellaris?
I'll probably play some RimWorld. I'll probably play a little bit more Factorio to just experiment with a few things like that I wanted to experiment with. I'm probably going to play a bunch of Enter the Gungeon, but I'll be doing that off stream because I can't stream it because Australian internet. I might go back and revisit the new Master of Orion. I started playing that. It was a little feature barren, but I think it's received updates since the last time I played it. If it hasn't, then there's probably updates coming very soon. So I want to check that out. I haven't really decided what's next on the list for me. I've been playing a little bit of everything. I played some Gremlins Inc. recently with a few of the guys. We did a board games night in Gremlins Inc. That game is a great proof of concept for designing a board game that is not a board game.
Yeah.
Like designing a board game that doesn't have a physical board that relies on a digital platform to be played as a board game. It's really, really interesting. So I'd have a look at it at some point if you're interested.
Yeah.
It's a lot of fun. So yeah, but I think that pretty much covers everything I wanted to talk about. I mean, we hit all the major points of addiction. We talked about stuff.
So we would
I'm pretty comfortable with that.
If you are a fan of this cast, you know, both of you, that watch this and like it over the other content in the channel, I would love some feedback on this format compared to the other format, because we could do theme shows more often. You know, I'm looking to, like, I would like this podcast to become its own show that exists independent of I like watching Llama Chomp because I like his live stream. Like, this podcast is sort of my foray onto YouTube content, and I would love it. I would love some feedback on how to make it better so that it can fill that role. So if you liked today's slightly different version, please feedback in my Twitch inbox or in YouTube comments is super, super welcome.
Yeah, or if you didn't and you want to see the old format, like, just feedback. You
know, right, not necessarily. I don't only want positive feedback. I want all of the feedback, because I do want to keep tuning and improving this show into whatever it is that would be the most successful.
Yeah, that's all I was going to get at. All right, well, we should do sign-offs then, I guess. You know that thing that we do at the end of every podcast where we, like, ramble?
Sort of awkwardly, because I'm bad at it. And haven't scripted it.
Yeah. We discussed it. We actually discussed off cast. We discussed, like, scripting an intro and scripting an outro.
Today really needed a script and intro. Part of the script would be unmute the microphone.
But yeah, no, I think we just sort of ramble on.
Okay, so I'll do yours, and then you do mine. He's Lolash.
Okay.
And if you search for Lolash or use that word on all of the things, the Twitches and the YouTubes and the stuff, he's the guy you'll find. And at the end of the show, if you're on YouTube, his Twitter link will be in the video player, but not in the comments, because I'm super bad at YouTube. And you should watch his live stream. He plays lots of the types of games we talk about on this show, and it's a lot of fun.
And he's... Am I right?
Other way.
He's Llama Chomp, and he's awesome. Me and Llama do tons of co-casted content. He is also available on all of the things. If you type Llama Chomp into Google, you'll find his website, which has direct, like, footage from Twitch. You can also find him on all of the Twitters and the YouTubes and that sort of thing. And we do tons of co-casted content together. So even if you just want to see more of me, even if you're like, I don't know about that Llama Chomp guy, but I really like Lolash, you should follow Llama Chomp as well, because I show up on his channel all the time.
Just like today.
So, yeah, like today. I'm on his channel. Not on my channel, just on his channel. So follow him. Even if you don't want to follow him, you should follow him. Just click the heart.
Do it because he said so.
Unless you've already clicked the heart. If you've already clicked the heart, then don't click it again. You want to click the heart an odd number of times. If you don't click the heart an odd number of times, then you'll unfollow him. You only ever not an even just.
And that would be super sad. Only. That would be super sad.
Yeah. It would be very sad.
Because you would lose some indication of when your voyeuristic window into my life is open, which I know you all desperately desire. Did I hit the awkward chord with that last? Are we
I
done?
Think you didn't.
Was that awkward enough? I can I just put the splash screen over, and we can.
I think the splash up, and we can just mute ourselves, and we can go out quietly and gracefully into the night.